Everybody, I'm Tammy Perchowski. I have the pleasure of being the executive director here at Star Theater. I want you to do me a favor. If you're brand new to Star and have never been here before, will you clap for me? I'm always so excited to see new faces and, of course, the veterans that come and support all of our shows. We appreciate all of you for coming out. A little bit about STAR before we get started. We are a nonprofit 501c3 organization, so absolutely everything you see here at STAR Theater is put on by volunteer effort. And that is a huge effort. But we absolutely love what we do, and if you see something that you like and you'd like to jump in and join us, we'd love to have you talk to one of us at intermission or after the show, and we'd be happy to get you on a mailing list and plug you in. Speaking of mailing lists, we do have, in the back, you can sign up for our email list if you'd like to know what's going on in the future, and I'm going to tell you about a few future events we have. We have a quilt show coming up on March 17th. This entire room is going to be covered with the most beautiful quilts from our local quilters that you have ever seen. This is free to the public, so we encourage everyone to come out and meet the ladies and gentlemen who put on this quilt show, and also our Arts Council here in Dallas County will be hosting a little get-together next door in the next building, so come and talk to us about the Arts Council if you'd like as well. How many of you heard of Blend? You see Blend here at Star. Well, you know, Blend broke up last year, but we are excited that their lead singer is carrying on, and we
Martha and I have been talking all week about your sermon last Sunday. It's really wonderful. Why, in only 2 short years, you have taken on the spirit of Brooklyn.
That's very gratifying, Mrs. Brewster.
You see, living here next to the church all our lives, we've seen so many ministers come and go. The spirit of Brooklyn, we all have friendliness. And your sermons are not so much sermons as friendly talks.
Personally, I've always enjoyed my talks with Cardinal Gibbons. Orne, have I met him yet?
Not yet, dear. Are the biscuits good?
Bully!
Won't you have another biscuit, Dr. Marvel?
Oh, no, thank you. I have no appetite for dinner now. I eat too many of your biscuits just to taste that lovely jam.
Oh, but you haven't even tried the quince. We always put a little apple in with it to take away the tartness.
No, thank you.
Well, I hope they don't make us use that imitation flour again. I mean, with all this war trouble. It's not very charitable of me, but I've almost come to the conclusion that this Mr. Hitler isn't a Christian.
Yes, if Europe were only on another planet.
Europe? Sir?
Why, yes, Teddy.
Point your gun the other way.
Gun?
Teddy.
To the west. There's your danger. There's your enemy, Japan!
Yes, of course.
Teddy?
No, Aunt Addie. Not so much talk about Europe and more about the canal.
Well, we just won't talk about war. Will you have another cup of tea, dear?
No, thank you, Aunt Abby.
Dr. Parker?
No, thank you. I must admit, war and violence seem so far removed from these surroundings.
It is peaceful here, isn't it?
Yes, peaceful. The virtues of another day. They're here in this house. The gentle virtues that went out with candlelight, good manners and low taxes.
Well, it's one of the oldest houses in Brooklyn. It's just as it was when Grandfather Brewster built and furnished it, well, except for the electricity, which we use as little as possible. Mortimer persuaded us to put it in.
Yes, I can understand that. Your nephew Mortimer seems to only live by electric light.
Well, he has to work so late, poor boy. I understand he's taking Elaine with him again to the theater tonight. Teddy, your brother Mortimer will be here a little later.
Delighted!
We're so happy as Elaine Mortimer takes to the theater with him.
Well, it's a new experience for me to wait up until 3 o'clock in the morning for my daughter to be brought home.
Dr. Parker, you don't disapprove of Mortimer.
Well...
We feel so guilty if you did, Sister Martha and I, since it was in our home that your daughter met Mortimer.
Yes, of course. Well, I'll be frank with you. I must admit that Mortimer seems to be quite a worthy gentleman, but must also admit I see the growing intimacy between me and my daughter with much trepidation. For one reason, Miss Abby.
You mean his stomach, Dr. Harper.
Stomach?
It's dyspepsia. He's bothered with it, so poor boy.
No, Miss Abby. I am talking about your nephew's unfortunate connection with the theater.
The theater? Oh, no, Dr. Harper. Mortimer writes for a New York newspaper.
Oh, I know, Miss Abby, I know. But a dramatic critic is constantly exposed to the theater, and I'm sure some develop an interest in it.
Well, not Mortimer. You need no fear of that. Why, Mortimer hates the theater.
Really?
Oh, he writes awful things about the theater. You can't really blame him, poor boy. He was so happy writing about real estate, which he actually knew something about. And then they made him take this terrible night position.
My.
Well, as he says, the theater can't last much longer anyway. But in the meantime, it's a living. So we'll give it another year or two, perhaps. Who do you suppose that is? No, thank you, Teddy. I'll go. Oh, come in, Miss Brophy.
Hello, Miss Brewster.
How are you, Miss Fly?
Well, Miss Brewster.
What news have you brought me?
Colonel, we have nothing to report.
Splendid! Thank you, ladies. At ease.
You know Dr. Harper.
Sure. Hello, Dr. Harper. We've come for the toys for the Christmas fun.
Oh, yes.
Oh, it's such fine work you ladies do. Fixing up discarded toys so poor children can have a happier Christmas.
It gives us something to do when we have to sit around the station. You get tired playing cards, and then you start cleaning your gun, and next thing you know, you shot yourself in the foot.
Teddy, go upstairs and get that big basket from your Aunt Martha's room. How is Mr. Brophy today? Mr. Brophy has been quite ill, Dr. Harper. Pneumonia.
Oh, I'm sorry to hear that.
He's better now, a little weak still. Oh, well, I'll go get some beef broth for you to take to him.
Oh, don't bother, Miss Abby. You've already done so much for him already.
Oh, we made it this morning. Sister Martha is taking some to poor Mr. Vinitsky right now. I'll just be a minute. Now, sit down. Make yourselves comfortable, all of you.
Listen, child, stop her or her sister for buying something nice and for nothing. They don't even care how you vote.
When I received my call to Brooklyn and moved next door, my wife wasn't well. When she died and months before, well, if I have known pure generosity and absolute kindness, it's because I've met the Brewster sisters.
Until I get those supplies.
It used to be that in the middle of the night, the neighbors raised Cain with us. They're a little afraid of him anyway.
He's practically harmless.
Suppose he does think he's Pinterestville. There are a lot worse people he could think he was.
Damn shame, a nice family like this hatching a cuckoo.
Their father, the old girl's brother, he was some sort of genius, wasn't he? And their father, Teddy's grandfather, seems to me he was a little crazy too.
Yeah, he was crazy, like a fox. He made $1 million.
Really? Right here in Brooklyn?
Yeah, patent medicine. He was a kind of a quack of some sort. Old Sergeant Edwards remembers him. used to house here as a sort of a clinic, trying them out on people.
Yeah, I've heard of you make mistakes occasionally, too.
Now, the department never bothered me much. He was pretty useful on autopsies sometimes, especially poison cases. Spend any of it on themselves.
Oh, yes, I'm well acquainted with their charities.
You don't know a tenth of it. When I was working in the Missing Persons Bureau, I was trying to trace an old man that I never did find. But did you know that there's a renting agency with this house on its list for furnished rooms? Well, they don't rent rooms, but you can bet that anyone who comes here looking for a room will go up a good meal and probably a few dollars in their kick.
And it's just their way of digging up people to do some good to. Well, now, isn't this nice?
Good afternoon, Miss Brewster.
How do you do, Miss Brophy? Dr. Harper, Miss Klein.
Hello, Miss Brewster. Will you come in for the voice?
Ah, yes. Teddy's Army and Navy. Well, they're all packed, but they do wear out.
The Colonel's upstairs after them. It seems the cabinet has to okay.
Oh, yes, of course. Is Mr. Brophy right there?
Oh, he's fine, ma'am. Your sister's gone to get some soup for me to take over to bed.
Yes, we made it this morning. I just took some to a poor man who broke oh so many bones.
Oh, Marvin, you're back. How was Mr. Vinitsky?
Well, dear, that's pretty serious, I'm afraid. The doctor was there. They're going to amputate in the morning.
Oh, can we be present?
No. I'm afraid he said we couldn't. He said it's against the rules of the hospital.
You ladies couldn't be of any service. Besides, you must spare yourself something.
Here's the broth, Miss Brophy. Make sure it's good and hot.
Yes, ma'am.
Oh, this is fine. Make a lot of kids happy. That O'Malley boy sure does about soldiers.
That's General Miles. I've retired him. What's this? The Oregon?
Not Teddy dear.
But the Oregon goes to Australia.
Yeah.
No, I've given my word to fighting Bob Evans.
But Teddy,
what difference was Kid to Bobby Evans, Dizzy Cohen? We'll be right along, ma'am. Thank you very much.
Oh, not at all.
Getting home too.
Oh, before you go.
Die! Die as a black cow!
The black house?
The stairs are always San Juan Hill.
Have you ever tried to convince him that he wasn't Teddy Roosevelt?
Oh, no.
He's so happy being Teddy Roosevelt.
What?
A long time ago, remember, Martha? We thought if he would be George Washington, it would be a nice change for him.
But he stayed under his bed for days and just wouldn't be anybody.
And we'd so much rather he be Mr. Roosevelt than nobody.
As long as he's happy. And what's more important than you're happy? Once forgot, will you please see that he signs these?
What are they?
Well, Dr. Parker has made all the arrangements for Teddy to go to Happydale Sanitarium after we pass on.
But why should he sign any papers now?
Oh, it's best to have it all settled. If the good Lord should take you away suddenly and we have to get Teddy to sign those papers himself, that could mean dozens. You know, that could lead to some very unpleasant legal procedures. Mr. Witherspoon understands that they're to be filed away until the time comes to use them.
Mr. Witherspoon?
Oh, he's the superintendent of Happydale.
Dr. Parker has arranged for him to drop by tomorrow or the next day to meet him.
Yes, well, I must be getting home before Elaine comes over here looking for me.
Give Elaine our love.
And Dr. Parker, don't think so harshly about Mortimer being a dramatic critic. Somebody has to do those things.
Did you just have tea? It's rather late, isn't it?
Oh, yes. And dinner's going to be late, too.
So, why?
Well, you see,
time you would get back, and Dr. Harper was coming.
But, Abby, all by yourself?
Oh, I got along just fine. Oh, Teddy! Good news for you, Teddy. You're going to Panama and dig another lock in the canal.
Delighted! That's bully! Just bully! I must get started immediately! Dad!
Abby, I think I'll go downstairs and see if everything's all right.
Oh, no, there was a time and I was all alone.
Well,
and Martha, just look at that window seat. Oh, it's Elaine.
Hey, dear.
Good afternoon, Miss Abby. Good afternoon, Miss Martha. I thought Father was here.
He left just this minute. Didn't you meet him?
Oh, no. I took a shortcut through the cemetery. Mortimer isn't here yet.
No, dear.
Oh, well, he asked me to meet him here. Do you mind if I wait?
Not at all.
You sit down, dear.
But we really must speak to Mortimer about doing this to you.
Doing what?
Well, he was brought up better than this. He knows that a gentleman, when he's taking a young lady out, should go to her house to call for her.
Well, there's something about calling for a girl at a parsonage that discourages any man who doesn't inform her.
No, he's done this to you too often. We are going to speak to him.
No, please don't. After going out with young men whose idea of nightlife was taking me to prayer meetings, it's wonderful to go to the theater almost every night of my life.
It is comforting for us too here. But because if Mortimer has to see some of those plays he has to see, at least he's sitting by a minister's daughter.
Elaine, what must you think of us not having the tea cleared away by this time?
Well, now, Abby, you don't worry with any of that until Mortimer gets here, and I'll come in and help you. Mortimer should be here any moment now.
Yes. Father must have been surprised to find me at home. I better run over and say goodnight to him.
Well, it's a shame you missed him.
Yes. If Mortimer comes, please tell him that I'll be right back. Oh, hello, Mort.
Hello, Elaine. Hello, Aunt Martha.
Abby, Mortimer's here.
Were you going somewhere?
Oh, I was just going to run over and tell Father goodnight.
Well, I didn't know that was still being done, even in Brooklyn.
Oh, Mortimer, how are you
here? It's Abby. I'm all right, and you look well. I mean, you haven't changed much since, well, yesterday.
That was yesterday, wasn't it? I were seeing a great deal of you lately. Well, come, sit down.
Abby, haven't we things to do in the kitchen?
Huh?
You know, the tea things?
Yes. Yes! The tea things. Now you can make yourselves right at home. Just you sit.
Make yourselves at right at home.
Well, can't you take a hint?
No, that was pretty obvious. A lack of inventiveness, I should say.
Yes, that's exactly what you'd say.
Where do you want to go for dinner?
I don't care. I'm not very hungry.
Well, I just had breakfast. Suppose we can wait till after the show.
That'd be pretty late, won't it?
Oh, not the little stinker we're going to go see. From what I've heard, we'll be at Blix by 10 o'clock.
You ought to be fair to these plays.
Have these plays ever been fair to me?
I have never seen you walk out on a musical.
Well, that musical isn't opening tonight.
No.
Oh, darling, you have to learn the rules. With a musical, there is always 4 changes of title and 3 postponements. I mean, they liked it in New Haven, but it still needs a lot of work.
I was hoping it would be a musical.
You have such a light mind.
Not at all.
between a raw schism and religion.
Religion never gets as high as the choir loft. Which reminds me, I have to tell Father not to wake up for midnight.
I've never been able to rationalize it.
What?
My, falling in love with a girl who lives in Brooklyn.
Falling in love? You're not stooping to the articulate, are you?
The only way I can regain my self-respect is to keep you in New York.
Did you say keep?
Oh, no, no, no. I've come to the conclusion that you're holding out for legalities.
Well, I can afford to be a good girl for quite some years yet.
Where can we go to be married in a hurry? Let's say, tonight?
Well, I'm afraid my father would want to officiate.
Oh, God. I bet your father didn't make a marriage service sound pedestrian.
Oh, you're not by chance writing a review on it, are you?
Oh, I'm sorry, darling. It's an occupational disease. Have you seen it?
Well, if you left it here, it must be here somewhere.
Well, when are you going to be married? What are your plans?
Surely there must be more you can tell us about Elaine.
Elaine? Oh, yes. Elaine thought it was brilliant.
What was, dear?
My chapter on Thoreau.
When Elaine comes back, I think we should have a little celebration. We should drink to their happiness. Martha, isn't there some of that Lady Baltimore cake left?
Oh, yes.
And I'll open a bottle of wine.
Where can I put that?
Now, Mortimer,
with your fiancé at your side tonight, I hope the play will be something you can enjoy for once. Maybe something romantic. What's the name of it?
Murder Will Out.
Oh, dear.
When the curtain goes up, the first thing you'll see will be a dead body.
Pictures.
where I was going. Remember? What word did I say? Well, it would take about half an hour to get to Brooklyn. What time have you got? That's right. Then I must be here. It's Abby. It's Martha. Come in here. What are we going to do? What are we going to do?
What are we going to do about what here?
Well, there's a body in there.
Yes, Mr. Hoskins.
Oh, good heavens. I can't turn you over to the police, but what am I going to do?
Well, for one thing, you're going to stop being so excited.
And for pity's sake, stop worrying. We told you to forget the whole thing.
Forget? Oh, my dear Aunt Tabby, I can't tell me you realize that something has to be done.
Yes, Lord, you behave yourself. You're too old to be flying off the handle like this.
Oh, Mr. Hotchkiss!
Hoskins.
Well, whatever his name is, you can't leave him like that.
Well, we don't intend to, dear.
And he's down in the canal right now, digging the log.
Do you mean to tell me you're going to bury Mr. Hotchkiss in the cellar?
Well, yes, dear. That's what we did with the others.
Oh, you can't bury Mr. others?
The other gentleman.
When you say others, do you mean like more than one other?
Well, yes. Let me see. This makes 11, doesn't it?
No, dear. This makes 12.
Oh, no, I think you're wrong. It's only 11.
Oh, no, because I remember that when Mr. Hoskins came in, it occurred to me that he would make just an even dozen.
But I really don't think I should count the first one.
I was counting the first one, and that makes it 12.
Hello? Hello? Well, hello, Ella. Oh, my, it's good to hear your voice.
Anyway, they're all down in the cellar.
Shh. Well, I was just calling because I felt a little parandillo, that's all. Oh, you won't know. But look, Al, I can't go cover the play tonight. I can't cover the play tonight. You gotta get George. Well, no, Al, you're wrong. Well, George has got to cover the play tonight. Well, it's my department, and I'm running it. Now get a hold of George. Now, where were we? 12?
Well, yes, dear. Abby thinks we should count the first one, and that makes 12.
All right. Well, tell me about the first one.
That was Mr. Midgley. He was a Baptist.
Just died.
Martha means without any help from us. You see, Mr. Midgley came here looking for a room.
That was right after you moved to New York.
And we just couldn't see that lovely room go to waste when there were so many people who needed it.
He was such a lonely old man.
And all his kith and kin had died, which made him so forlorn and unhappy.
We felt so sorry for him.
Then his heart attack came, and he sat dead in that chair, looking so peaceful that we made up our minds then and there that if we could help other lonely old men to that same peace, we would.
He died right in that chair. Well, how awful for you.
Oh, no, dear. Why, it was rather like old times. You know, your grandfather always had a cadaver or two lying around the house.
Hello? Just hold on a minute, George. All right, it's important. But it can wait a minute, can't it? minute. Just hold on. Now, Elaine, you're a sweet girl, and oh, I love you. Something's on my mind now, and I need you to run along home and wait for me to call you.
Don't be so masterful!
Oh, when we're married and I have problems to face, I hope you're less tedious and uninspired.
And when we're married, if we're married, I hope I find you adequate.
Thank you. fast, and I'll pan the hell out of it. But look, Al, you've got to do something for me. Get a hold of O'Brien, a lawyer, or the head of the legal department. Get him to meet me at the theater. Now, don't let me down. You can do this for me. All right, I'm starting now. Listen, darlings, I've got to go to the theater, and I can't get out. Before I go, will you promise me something?
We'd have to know it was first.
Well, you know I love you, but I know you love me too. And I know that you know that I would do anything in the world for you, so I'm asking you to do this tiny little thing for me.
What do you want us to do?
Oh, don't do anything. Well, I mean don't do anything. Don't let anyone in this house and leave Mr. Hoskins where he is.
Why?
Well, because I want time to think. Oh, and I've got quite a lot to think about, too. Oh, you know I wouldn't want anything bad to happen to you.
What on earth could happen to us?
Well, anyway, you'll do this for me, won't you?
Well...
Services?
Well, certainly. You wouldn't expect us to bury Mr. Hoskins without a full Methodist service, would you? Why, he was a Methodist.
But can't that wait till I get back?
Then you can join us.
Yes. Yes.
Oh, Mortimer, you'll enjoy the services, especially the hymns. Remember how beautifully Mortimer used to sing in the choir?
You're not going to let anyone in the house. That's a promise.
Well, now, Martha, I think we can do this now that Mortimer is cooperating with us.
Well, Mortimer, all right.
All right, huh? Well, do you have any paper? I'll be back as soon as I can. There's a man I have to see.
Here's some stationery. Will this do?
Well, that'll be fine. I can save some time if I write my review on the way to the theater.
Mortimer wasn't quite himself tonight, was he?
Well, it's only natural, and I think I know why.
Why?
Well, he's just become engaged to be married. I suppose that makes any man nervous.
I'm really happy for Elaine, and their honeymoon should give them a real vacation. I don't think Mortimer got much rest this summer.
Well, at least he didn't go kiting off to China or Spain.
I never could understand why he wanted to go to those places.
Well, I think to Mortimer, the theater is pretty small potatoes. He needs something bigger to criticize. Yeah. You know, like the human race.
Eddie, if Mortimer's coming back for Mr. Hoskins' services, we'll need another hymnal. I have one in my room.
Well, dear, you know it's really my turn to read the services. But since you were out when Mr. Hoskins came, I want you to do it.
Oh, that's so very nice of you, dear. But are you sure you want me to?
Oh, it's only fair.
Well, I think I'll wear my black bombazine and mother's old brooch.
I'll go, dear.
We promised Mortimer we wouldn't let anyone in.
Well, who do you suppose it is?
Wait a minute, I'll look. It's two men and I've never seen them before.
Are you sure?
There's a car parked at the curb. They must have come in that.
Well, let me look.
Do you recognize them?
No, they're total strangers to me.
Well, we'll just have to pretend we're not at home.
Ha ha ha! escape from this place. Now I'm happy to escape back into it.
Yeah, Johnny. It's a fine hideout.
The family must have still lived here. There's something so unmistakably Brewster about the Brewsters. I hope there's a fatted calf awaiting the return of the prodigal.
Yeah, Johnny, I'm hungry. Look, drinks!
As though we were expected. A good omen.
Who are you? And what are you doing here?
What? Aunt Abby! Aunt Martha! It's Jonathan.
You get out of here!
I'm Jonathan, your nephew, Jonathan.
Oh, no, you're not. You're nothing like Jonathan, so don't pretend you are. Now you just get out of here.
But I am Jonathan, and this is Dr. Einstein.
He's not Dr. Einstein, either.
Not Dr. Albert Einstein. Dr. Herman Einstein.
Who are you? You are not our nephew, Jonathan.
Well, Aunt Abby, I see you're wearing that lovely garnet ring that Grandma Brewster brought back from England. And Aunt Martha, still the high collar to hide the burn, where the scar where Grandfather's acid burned you?
His voice is like Jonathan's.
Have you been in an accident?
Oh, no. My face, that's Dr. Einstein's doing. He's a plastic surgeon. He changes people's faces.
But I've seen that face before. Abby, remember when we took the little Schultz boy to the movies and I was so frightened? It was that face.
Easy, Tommy. Easy. Easy, Tommy. Hello, fairy ladies. It's the last 5 years I get Johnny's 3 new faces. This last one, then I saw that picture too, just before I operate. And I was intoxicated.
You see, doctor, what you did to me? Even our own family sucks on my mind.
Johnny, you're home in this lovely house. How often he tells me about this house, about Brooklyn, about his aunts that he loves so much. Johnny, Zeno, it's you? Zeno, it's you. Just speak to him. Tell him so.
Well, Jonathan, it's been a long time. What have you been doing all these years?
Yes, Jonathan, where have you been?
Well, England, South Africa, Australia. The last 5 years in Chicago, Dr. Einstein and I had a business trip.
We were in Chicago for the World's Fair.
Yes, we found it awfully warm.
Yeah, it got hot for us too.
Well, aunties, it's so wonderful to be in Brooklyn. And you look just as I remember you. You're so sweet, so charming, and so hospitable. And Teddy, dear Teddy, did he ever go into politics? My brother, Doctor, was determined to become president.
Teddy's fine, just fine. And Mortimer is well, too.
Oh, yeah. Mortimer. I know all about Mortimer. I've seen his picture at the head of his column. It seems he's fulfilled all the promise of his early nasty nature.
We're very fond of Mortimer.
Well, Jonathan, it was very nice for you to drop by to see us.
Bless you, Aunt Martha. It's good to be home.
Martha, we don't want what's on the stove to boil over.
Yes, if you'll excuse us a minute, Jonathan. Unless, of course, you're in a hurry to go somewhere.
Well, Johnny, where do we go from here? We have to sing fast. So police have pictures as a face. We got to operate on you right away. We gotta find a place for that. We gotta find a place for Mrs. Spinoza too.
Don't waste any worry on that rat.
But Johnny, we got a hot stiff on our hands.
Forget about Mr. Spinoza.
But
You can't leave a body in the bumble seat. You shouldn't have killed him, Tommy. He's a nice fellow. He gives us a lift, and what happens?
He said I looked like Boris Karloff. That's you're new, and you did that.
But, Johnny, we find a place somewhere. I'll fix you up quick.
Tonight.
But no, Johnny, I'm tired, and I got to eat first. I'm hungry.
Okay.
Jonathan. It was nice of you to take the trouble to come in and see us and say hello. But you were never happy in this house, and we were never happy while you were in it. So we've just come in to say goodbye.
Andrew, I can't say I'm surprised by your feelings toward me. I spent a great many hours regretting the heartache I must have caused you as a boy.
You were quite a triumph to us, Jonathan.
But my one real disappointment is for Dr. Einstein. I promised him that no matter how busy we were coming through Brooklyn, that I'd bring him by here for one of Aunt Martha's home-cooked meals.
Oh! I don't think there will be enough.
Oh, Abby, it's a pretty good-sized pot roast.
Pot roast?
I think the least we could do would be...
Thank you, Aunt Martha. We'll stay to dinner.
Well, we'll hurry it along.
Yes.
Oh, Jonathan, if you would like to freshen up, you can use the washroom in your grandfather's old laboratory.
Is that still there?
Oh, yes, just as he left it. I'll go help Martha in the kitchen get things started. Since we're all in a hurry.
Well, at least you're getting a meal anyway.
Grandfather's laboratory! Doctor! The perfect operating room!
Oh, but too bad we can't use it.
When you're finished with me, we can make a fortune here. The laboratory, the large ward up in the attic, 10 beds, Doctor! And Brooklyn is crying out for your talents.
Oh, Johnny, why put yourself up? Anything for Brooklyn, I think a year too late.
You don't know Brooklyn. Practically everyone in town needs a new face.
Yes, but so many of the old faces are blocked up.
A very small percentage. And the boys in Brooklyn are famous for paying generously to stay out of jail.
Yes, Johnny, your aunts, they don't want us here.
We're here for dinner, aren't we?
Yes, but after dinner.
Leave it to me. This house will be our headquarters for years.
Oh, that would be beautiful. This nice of yours. I love them already. Now, I'll go get the bags, yeah?
Doctor, wait until we're invited.
But you just said that.
We'll be invited.
And if they say no?
Two helpless old women.
As that comes true, a beautiful dream. Only, I hope you're not dreaming. Ugh, it's so peaceful.
Yes, Doctor, that's what makes this house so perfect for us. It's so peaceful. Yes, aunties, those 5 years in Chicago were among the busiest and happiest of my life.
And from Chicago, we go to South Bend, Indiana.
Oh, I don't think they'd be interested in our experiences in Indiana, Doctor.
Jonathan, you've led a very
meeting Dr. Einstein in London.
I must say, it changed my life. You remember, I was in South Africa in the diamond business, and I went to Amsterdam for the diamond market, and I wanted to go back to South Africa. It was meeting Dr. Einstein that made that possible.
It's a good job, Tony. Then you take all the advantages. His face looks so different. The nurse had to introduce me.
I love that face. I still carry the photograph.
It does look more like the way you used to look, but I still wouldn't know you.
Let's go back to that face, Doctor.
Nah, it's safe now.
Well, I know you both want to get where you're going.
Oh, aunties. After that marvelous meal, I couldn't move a muscle.
Yeah, it's nice here.
Well, after all, it's awfully late.
I found it! I found it!
What did you find, Teddy?
The story of my life! My biography! Here's the picture I was telling you about, General. Here we are, both of us. President Roosevelt and General Dunkels at Culebra Cut. That's me, General! And that's you!
My! How I've changed!
Well, you see, that picture hasn't been taken yet. We haven't even started work on the Culebra Cut. We're still digging locks! And now, General, we will both go to Panama and inspect the new lock.
No, Teddy, not to Panama.
Oh, no, we go some other time. Panama's a long way off.
Nonsense! It's just down in the cellar.
The cellar?
We let him dig the Panama Canal in the cellar.
General Goldfuss, as President of the United States, Commander and Chief of the Army and Navy, and the man who gave you this job, I demand that you accompany me on the inspection of the new lock.
Teddy, I think it's time you went to bed.
I beg your pardon. Who are you?
I'm Woodrow Wilson. Go to bed.
No, you're not Wilson. But your face is familiar. You're not anyone I know now. Perhaps later. On my hunting trip to Africa. Yes, you look like someone I might meet in the jungle.
It's Brother Jonathan, dear.
He's had his face changed.
So that's it. A nature faker.
Perhaps you should go to bed. Jonathan and his friend need to get back to their hotel.
General Goethals, inspect the canal.
All right. Mr. President, we go to Panama.
Boy! Follow me, General! It's down south, you know?
Bon voyage!
Aunt Abby, I must correct a misapprehension. You mentioned our hotel. We have no hotel. We came directly here.
Well, there's a very nice little hotel about there.
Aunt Martha, this is my home.
But Jonathan, you can't stay here. We need our rooms.
You need the rooms?
For our lodgers.
Are there lodgers in this house?
Well, not right this minute, but we plan to have some.
Oh, well, then my old room is free.
But there's no place for Mr. Einstein.
He'll share the room with me.
No, Jonathan, you can't stay here.
Dr. Einstein and I need a place to sleep. Earlier this afternoon, you remembered that as a boy I could be...
disagreeable. Now, it wouldn't be very pleasant for any of us if...
Perhaps we should let them stay tonight.
Well, just overnight, Jonathan.
Wow, it's settled, then. Please, get our room ready.
It only needs airing out.
Keep it ready to show the lodgers. I'm sure you and Dr. Einstein will find it very comfortable.
You have a very distinguished guest in Dr. Einstein. You don't yet appreciate his skill, but you will. In a few short weeks, I'll look like a very different Jonathan.
He can't operate on you here.
When Dr. Einstein and I get organized, when we resume our practice... Oh, I forgot to tell you. We're converting Grandfather's laboratory into an operating room.
No, Jonathan, we will not let you turn this house into a hospital.
A hospital? Heavens no! It will be a beauty parlor.
Sorry, that is a salary full for me.
Oh, good news, Doctor. My aunts have invited us to live with them.
Oh, okay. You fixed it.
Just overnight.
Please, get our room ready immediately.
Well, for tonight.
Johnny, when I go down in the cellar, what do you think I find?
What?
The Panama Canal!
The Panama Canal.
It's a whole teddy duck. It just fits Mrs. Spinazzo. 6 feet long and 4 feet wide.
Down there?
You think they knew the ring, Mrs. Spinazzo. That's hospitality!
Quite a joke on my aunt, having a body buried in their cell.
Yes, now, how did we get him in?
Oh, yes, we can't just bring him in through the front door, can we? I know. I'll pull the car up between the house and the cemetery, and after they have gone to bed, we'll just bring him in through the window.
Oh, bed. Just think, Johnny. We got to bed tonight.
Easy, Doctor. You're operating tomorrow. You'd better be sober.
Oh, I fix you up beautiful.
And if you don't, I'll
tell
you,
Johnny.
Jonathan, your room is ready.
Oh, good. Then you two can just go on to bed. I'm pulling the car up behind the house.
Oh, don't do that. It's all right where it is. Until morning.
Oh, no. I wouldn't want to leave it on the street. That might be illegal.
What are we going to do?
We're not going to let them stay more than one night in this house, for one thing. What would the neighbors think? People coming in with one face and going out with another.
But, Abby, what are we going to do about Mr. Hoskins?
Oh, Mr. Hoskins. It can't be very comfortable for him in there. He's been so patient, the poor dear. Well, I think we just have to tell Ted to get Mr. Hoskins downstairs right away.
Well, I think if Teddy, but should I call Teddy?
He's down in the cell.
I think I will. Teddy!
General Goethals was very pleased. He says the canal is just the right size.
Teddy, there's been another yellow fever victim.
This will be a shock to the general.
Well, then we mustn't tell him about it.
But it's his department.
No, we mustn't tell him, Teddy. He will just spoil his visit.
I'm sorry, Aunt Abby. He'll have to be told. Army regulations, you know.
No, we must keep it a secret.
Yes.
A state secret?
Yes.
Promise?
A state secret.
You have the word of the President of the United States. Cross my heart and hope to die. Now, how are we going to keep it a secret?
When you're going to go down in the cellar, and when I turn the lights off, when it's all dark, you're going to come up and take the poor man to the canal. Now run along, Teddy.
And then we'll come down later and hold services.
You may announce the president will say a few words. Where is the poor devil?
Oh, he's in the window seat.
It seems to be spreading. We've never had yellow fever that before.
Martin, when Jonathan and Dr. Einstein come back, let's see if we can get them to go to bed right away.
Yes, then by the time they're asleep, we'll be dressed for the funeral and we can hold services. Abby, I've never even seen Mr. Hoskins.
That's right, you were out. Will you just come right here and look at him now? He's really very nice looking, considering he's a Methodist.
We're bringing luggage in through here.
Jonathan, your room is waiting for you. You can go right up.
Oh, I'm afraid we don't keep Brooklyn hours, but you two can run along to bed.
Oh, but you must be tired, both of you. And besides, you don't go to bed this early.
Well, you should. It's good that I've come home to take care of you.
But we weren't planning to go to bed.
Aunt Martha, did you hear me say go to bed? No, Doctor, the instrument case can go up to the laboratory in the morning. But right now, let's just all go to bed.
Well, I'll wait right here until you're up, and then I'll turn out the lights.
One more flight, Doctor. Run along, Aunt Martha. All right, Aunt Abby.
I'll be right up.
Now, Aunt Abby, turn out the light.
Thank you.
doctor, get the lights. You picked an inopportune time for a social call.
I think you better explain what you're doing here.
We happen to live here.
You don't live here. I'm in this house every day and I've never seen you before. Where's Miss Abby and Miss Martha? What have you done to them?
Perhaps we'd better introduce ourselves. This is Dr. Einstein.
Dr. Einstein.
Yes, a surgeon of great distinction and something of a magician.
And I suppose you're going to tell me your wars...
I'm Jonathan Brewster.
Oh, you're Jonathan.
You've heard of me?
Yes, for the first time this afternoon.
What did they say about me?
Only that there was another brother named Jonathan. That's all that was said. Well, now that I know who you are, there's really no reason to bother Miss Abby. I'll be on my way. If you will kindly unlock the door.
Well, that explains everything. What did you mean by that? Why did you come here tonight?
Thought I saw someone prowling around the house.
You thought you saw someone prowling around the house?
Yes. Wasn't that you? Isn't that your car?
You saw someone at the car?
Yes.
What else did you see?
Just someone walking around the house to the car.
What else did you see?
That's it, that's all. I wanted to come over here to tell Miss Abby to call the police, but if that was you and that's your car, then there's really no reason to bother Miss
Abby. What was the man doing at the car?
I don't know. I was on my way over here.
I think you're lying.
No, I think she tells the truth.
I think she's lying. Breaking into a house like this, and at this time of night, I think she's dangerous. I don't think she should be allowed to run around loose.
Get your hands off me!
It's going to be a private funeral.
Teddy! Tell these men who I am!
That's my daughter, Alice!
But first thing in the morning, out. Now, where are they sleeping?
We put them in Jonathan's old room.
Well, that's my old room. I'm sleeping in that room. I'm here to stay.
It's all right, Johnny. We sit down here. You sleep on the couch, and I'll sleep on the window seat.
The window seat? Well, let's not argue about it. The window seat is good enough for me. I'll sleep on the window seat.
You know, all this argument, it makes me think of Mrs. Spinozzo.
Mortimer, there's no reason we should inconvenience you at all. We'll sleep down here.
Jonathan, your sudden consideration for me is very unconvincing.
Come along, Johnny. We go pack our things now, eh?
Don't bother, Doctor.
Doctor, I seem to have completely lost track of Mr. Spinozzo.
Who is this Mr. Spinozzo?
Just a friend of ours that Johnny has been looking for.
Well, don't bring anyone else here.
Oh, but come along, Johnny. I'll tell you all about it when we pack.
Mortimer, you don't have to sleep down here. I'll go in with Martha and you can take my room.
It's no trouble at all, Aunt Abby. It'll only take us a few minutes to pack and then, Mortimer, you can have the room.
Well, you're just wasting your time. I told you I'm sleeping down here.
Mortimer!
What's the matter with you, dear?
I've almost been killed!
Why, you've almost been... Abby! Martha!
No! It was Jonathan.
He mistook her for a sneak thief.
No, it was worse than that. He's some kind of maniac. Mortimer, I'm afraid of him.
My darling, you're trembling. Do you have any smelling salts?
No, but how about some hot tea or coffee?
Coffee, and make some for me, too. And some sandwiches. I haven't had dinner.
We'll make some for both of you.
Oh, Martha, we can leave our hats downstairs here now.
If you weren't going somewhere, were you? I mean, do you know what time it is? It's past 12. 12? Lady, you've got to go home.
What? You wanted some sandwiches for both of you. It'll just take a minute.
Why, yes, remember? Remember when we celebrated your engagement. That's what we'll do. We'll make a nice supper for the both of you, and we'll open a bottle of wine.
All right. No wine!
What is going on in this house?
What do you mean, what's going on in this house?
We were supposed to go to dinner and the theater tonight. You called it off. You asked me to marry you, and I said I would, and then 5 minutes later, you kicked me out of the house. And then, after your brother tries to strangle me, you want to chase me home. Now listen, Mr. Brewster, before I go home, I want to know where I stand. Do you love me?
I love you very much, Elaine. Well, in fact, I love you so much that I can't marry you.
Have you gone crazy?
No, I don't think so. But it's only a matter of time, and Senate he runs in my family. Practically gallops.
Hey, you.
Oh, you know Teddy. He thinks he's Roosevelt. No, dear. No Brewster should marry. And I realize that now, and if I had met my father in time, I would have stopped him.
This doesn't prove that you're crazy. Look at your aunts. They're Brewsters, aren't they? They're the sweetest, sanest people I have ever known.
Well, even they have a peculiarities.
Yes! Oh, my lovely peculiarities. Kindness, generosity, human sympathy.
There's another one!
Martha, you just see what's in that window seat.
Patty, I owe you an apology. And good news, Jonathan is leaving. And he's taking Dr. Einstein and their coal companion with them. Now, Jonathan, you're my brother, and you're Brewster, so I'm going to give you a chance to get away and take the evidence with you. And you can't ask for more than that. You've left me no choice. I guess I'll have to phone the police.
Don't reach for that phone, Mortimer. Are you still trying to give me orders after seeing what happened to Mr. Spinoza?
And also, I knew it was a foreigner.
Remember, what happened to Spinoza can happen to you, too.
Hello, Miss Abby.
Hello, Officer O'Hara.
I'm not a creative writer.
I'll do the creating. You just put the words to it.
Oh, good.
No, I ain't leaving this house until I tell you the fuck.
Well, in that case, murderer, we'll just be running along.
No, you can't go yet. Don't try that. You've got to take everything with you. You know. Now, hair up. My brother should know.
I've been waiting 12 years.
I'm sorry I was so long.
Don't bring that in here. Well, hair up. Will you join us for buying the kitchen?
The kitchen?
Jonathan is leaving.
Oh, well, that's nice. Come on, Officer O'Hara.
Officer O'Hara, you don't mind eating in the kitchen.
Well, where else would you eat?
Goodbye, Jonathan. It's been nice to see you again.
You know, Jonathan, I'm glad you came back to Brooklyn. It gave me a chance to pick you out. And the first one out will be your boyfriend, Mr. Spinazzo.
Hey, Mr. Brewster, we can talk in here.
Well, I'm coming right out.
I might have known you'd grow up to ride a play with a policeman.
Now get going. All three of you.
This affair between my brother and me has got to be settled, Doctor.
Johnny, your brother, he gives us a chance to get to Vague. What more could you ask for?
You don't understand. This has been going on for a good many years.
Now, Johnny, let's get going.
No. We're not going anywhere. We're sleeping here tonight.
Johnny, the department's the kitchen and Mrs. Spinazzo's in window seats.
That's all he's got on us. We'll take Spinazzo down and dump him in the bay and come right back here. And if he tries to interfere...
Now, Johnny.
Doctor, can you see I've made up my mind?
Yes. Yes. When you make up your mind, you lose your head. Brooklyn ain't a good place for you, Johnny.
Doctor.
Okay. We stick together, but if we get stuck together and we're coming back here someday, do we gotta take these with us?
No. Hide them downstairs. Move fast. Spinazzo can go out the same way he came in.
No. Wait for me.
waiting for a chance like this for a good many years.
We got to fight where we want him. Did he look guilty?
Why don't you take our bags back upstairs, huh?
Have they gone? We thought we heard someone leave.
Oh, it was just Mortimer. He'll be back in a few minutes. Dr. Einstein and I are hungry. And is there anything left in the kitchen? We're fine.
But you won't have time.
Well, why don't you make us a sandwich, and we'll bury Mr. Spinalzo down in the cellar.
Oh, no!
He can't stay in our cellar. No, Jonathan. You'll have to take him with you.
Oh, there's a friend of Mortimer's down there waiting for him.
A friend of Mortimer's?
Yes, he and Mr. Spinalzo should get along quite well together. They're both dead.
He must be Mr. Hoskins.
Mr. Hoskins?
You know about what's down in the cellar?
Well, of course, but he's no friend of Mortimer's. He's one of our gentlemen.
Your gentleman?
Yes, and we won't have any strangers buried in our cellar.
But Mr. Hoskins?
He's not a stranger.
Besides, there's no room for Mr. Spinalzo. The cellar's crowded already.
Crowded with what?
There are 12 graves down there now.
12 graves?
Which means there's very little room and we're going to need it.
Well then, you and Aunt Martha have murdered 12 people?
Murdered? Certainly not. It's one of our charities.
All we do is a mercy.
Which means you'll just have to get your Mr. Spinalzo out of here.
All these years, you've done that here in this house, and you've buried him down there.
Johnny, we've traveled all around the world, and they stay right here in Brooklyn and do just as good as you do. They got 12, and we got 12.
No. I got 13.
Not 12.
No, 13. There's Mr. Spinalzo, and the first one in London, two in Johannesburg, one in Sydney, one in Melbourne, two in San Francisco, the one in Phoenix, Arizona.
Phoenix?
The filling station.
Oh, yes, yes.
Three in Chicago, and one in South Bend. That's 13.
Oh, no, but you can't count the one in South Bend. He died of pneumonia.
He wouldn't have died of pneumonia if I hadn't shot him first.
No, Johnny. He died of pneumonia. He don't count.
He counts with me. I say 13.
No, Johnny. 12. You have 12 and they have 12. So old ladies are just as good as you are.
They are they? Well, that's easy to take care of. All I need is one more. Just one more.
Well, here I am.
You'll find out whose house this is.
I'm warning you. You stop it right now. Martha, has Mortimer come back yet? Terrible thing, marrying a good Methodist with a foreigner.
Abby, I will not have our cellar desecrated.
Poor Mr. Hoskins. We promised him a full Christian funeral. Where do you suppose he went?
I don't know, but he must be doing something because when Mortimer left, I heard him tell Jonathan, "You just wait, I'll settle this."
Well, he can't very well settle it if he's not in the house. And what we want settled is what's going on down there.
All right, now, where's Penny?
Mortimer, where have you been?
Well, I've been over at Dr. Gilchrist to get a signature on Penny's commitment papers.
Mortimer, what's the matter with you?
Running around getting papers signed at a time like this.
Do you know what Jonathan's doing?
You're putting Mr. Hoskins in with Mr. Spinalzo.
Oh, he is, Dizzy. Well, let him. Is Teddy in his room?
Teddy won't be any help.
Oh, to sign these commitment papers, I can tackle Jonathan.
Well, what did they have to do with it?
Well, you had to go tell Jonathan about those 13 bodies in the cellar. And if I can make Teddy responsible for those, I can protect you. Don't you see?
No, I don't see. We pay good taxes so that the police can protect us.
I'm coming. I'll be back down in a minute.
Well, maybe we should just go to the police ourselves, Abby.
Yes.
All right. Police! You can't go to the police!
Why can't we?
You can tell the police about Mr. Smanazzo. They'll find Mr. Austin's too, and well, and that might make them curious, and they might find out about the other 12 gentlemen.
Now, Mortimer, I think we know the police better than you do. And if they wouldn't pry into our private affairs, and we ask them not to.
Well, if they found your other 12 gentlemen, they'll have to report it to headquarters.
Oh, I don't think they'd bother. Why, they'd have to write out a very long report. And if there's anything the police needs to do, it's to write.
You can't count on that. It might leak out. Oh, and you can't expect the judge or jury to understand.
Judge Coleman would.
We know him very well.
He comes to church all the time to pray, just before election.
Coming to tea someday, too, he promised.
Oh, Abby, we must speak to him again about that. His wife died a few years ago and has left him very low.
Come along, Abby.
I won't let you. You can't go to the police, and you can't leave this house, and you can't have Judge Coleman for tea.
Well, if you're not going to do something about Mr. Spinazzo, we are.
Oh, I am going to do something, and I might have to call the police later, but if I do, I want to be ready for them.
You have got to get Jonathan out of this house.
Oh, will you please let me do this my own way?
Mr. Spinazzo, too.
Just let me do this my own way, will you?
Well, now, Mortimer, if they're not out of here by morning, we are going to call the police.
Oh, they'll be out of here. I promise you that. Now, go to bed, will you? And for God's sake, get out of those clothes. You look like Judith Anderson.
Well, Abby, that's a relief, isn't it?
If Mortimer is going to do something at last, then that just means Jonathan is going to a lot of unnecessary trouble. And we better tell him.
Oh,
Mortimer, you'll just have to stop what you're doing.
It's already done. Did I hear Mortimer?
Well, it will just have to be undone. You're all going to be out of this house by morning. Mortimer has promised.
Oh, he has he? Well, in that case, why don't you two just go on to bed and have a pleasant night's rest?
Yes, Abby, come.
Good night, aunties.
Not good night, Jonathan. Goodbye. By the time we get up, you'll be out of this house, Mortimer's promised.
And he has a way of doing it, too.
Oh, is Mortimer back then?
Oh, yes, he's up here talking with Teddy.
Good night, Jonathan. Goodbye.
Goodbye, Jonathan.
Perhaps you'd better say goodbye to Mortimer.
Oh, you'll see Mortimer.
Yes. I'll see Mortimer.
All right. Oh, so it's all fixed up. Smooth like a lake. Oh, no one ever knows if it's down there. Oh, bed. 48 hours we didn't get to sleep. Now we go to bed now, eh?
You're forgetting, Doctor.
What?
My brother, Mortimer.
Johnny, tonight, we do that tomorrow, what's the next day?
No, tonight, now!
But Johnny, we go to bed and tomorrow I'm going to operate.
Yes, Doctor, tomorrow you operate, but tonight we take care of Mortimer.
Johnny.
Doctor, look at me. Can you see this is going to be done?
Okay, I see. I know that look.
It's a little late to dissolve our partnership now, don't you think?
Yes. All right, we do it, but it's a quick way. It's a quick twist, like in London.
Oh, no. Oh, this is a special occasion.
I'm thinking perhaps
what?
The Melbourne method.
Johnny, no! The Melbourne method? 2 hours and dinner's all over, sir. The home in London was just as dead as the fellow in Melbourne.
We were too rushed in London. There was no aesthetic satisfaction to it, no. But Melbourne, now, there was something to remember.
No, no. Remember, I wish I did it.
Doctor, where are your instruments?
I won't do it, Johnny. I won't do it.
Go get your instruments.
Well, Johnny.
Where are they?
The cellar. You hid them in the cellar. Where?
I won't tell you, Johnny.
I'll find them.
No, Mr. President, you can't do that. I cannot sign any proclamation without consulting my cabinet.
Well, there must be a secret.
A secret?
How unusual.
Yes, Japan mustn't know until it is signed.
Japan? Those yellow devils! I'll sign it right away! I can let the cabinet know later.
Yes, well, let's go sign.
No, a secret proclamation has to be signed in secret.
What's Mr. President?
I have to put on my signing clothes.
Something important?
No, you go now.
No, Doctor. You know, you seem like a nice fellow and all, and I've nothing against you. So, well, take my advice and get out of this house and as far away as possible.
No, my trouble, yeah. No, you get out.
Oh, don't say I didn't warn you, Doctor.
I'm warning you. Get out. Quick!
Oh, things are going to start popping around here. Any minute.
Listen, Johnny, he's in a bad mood. Thinking like this, he's a madman. Things happen. Terrible things.
Oh, Jonathan doesn't worry me now.
Don't those places you see just teach you anything?
About what?
That at least people in place act like they got sense. Sense more than you do.
Huh. Oh, you think so, do you? Well, you think people in place act intelligently. Well, I wish you had to sit through some of the ones I've had to sit through. Well, take a little opus I saw tonight, for instance. Well, in this play, there's a man who's supposed to be intelligent. Well, he knows he's in a house with murderers. He ought to know he's in danger. I mean, he's even been warned to get out of the house. But does he go? No, he stays. So I ask you, Doctor, is that what an intelligent person would do?
You're asking me.
He didn't even have sense enough to be frightened or to be on guard. For instance, a murderer asked him to sit down.
I mean, won't you sit down?
Oh, believe it or not, Doctor, that one was in there too.
Oh, and what did he do?
Well, he sat down. Now, mind you, this guy is supposed to be bright. And every sits is waiting to be trussed up. And what do you think they used to tie him up with?
What?
The curtain cord.
I mean, very convenient.
A little too convenient, if you ask me. When are the playwrights going to get some imagination? I mean, the curtain cord.
I mean, didn't he seem dizzy?
See him? No, he sat with his back right to him. This is the kind of stuff I have to suffer through. Night after night. Say tricks in the theater, but it's the playwrights that are killing the theater. So, yes, well, there he sits. This guy who's supposed to be intelligent.
The big dope.
He just sits there, waiting to be trussed up and gagged. Jonathan! Einstein! Einstein, let me go!
If you don't mind, I'll finish the story. 20 years. 20 years, Mortimer. And in all that time, you have never left my mind. One night in Delmer, I dreamed of you. And then I landed in San Francisco. I felt a strange satisfaction. You and I in the same country together. Now we go to work, Doctor.
Oh, Johnny, please, pull me. It's a quick vein.
Doctor, I'm surprised at you. Can't you see? This must be an artistic achievement. After all, we're performing before a very distinguished critic. Oh, Doctor, I'm ready for it.
Oh, please, I have to have a drink first. I can't do this without a drink.
Pull yourself together.
No, I can't do this without a drink. Now, when we first came in here, it was fine, remember? Now, where did she put that? Look, we both need a drink. All of us right now, so long and since we help us calm down. Now, there's plenty of enough for the both of us. Come on. I spent it with you, okay? All right. Here you go.
Doctor, wait. Where are your manners? Mortimer, I realize now it was you who brought me back to Brooklyn. Doctor, to my dear dead brother. Oh, damn it! That's it! That's it!
No,
and he goes back! He goes back!
Johnny! We don't get to Teddy! We don't get to him!
We get to Teddy later.
No, we don't get to him at all!
Well, now we've got to move fast.
Yes, Johnny! It's a quick way!
Yes, Doctor. The quick way.
Hey! The cops might quit blowing that horn!
It's all right, officer. We'll take the bugle away from it.
There's going to be hell pay in the morning. We promised the neighbors he wouldn't do that anymore.
It won't happen again, officer. Good night.
I'd better speak to myself. Where are the lights? Hey! You stood me up! I waited for over an hour at Kelly's for you.
He was explaining the play he saw tonight. Is that what happened to the fellow in the play?
That was in the play you saw tonight. Well, they practically stole that from the second act of my play. Why, in the second act of my play, just before the... No, I better begin it again. There she is. Waking up. Dressing her up. Hold on. So there she is, in her dressing room, making up, see, when this man walks in through the door with a black mustache and looks at my mother and says, Miss Latour, will you marry me? She doesn't know, he doesn't know she's pregnant. Lingerie. The chick is standing over her with a hatchet, tied up, just like you are. The place is an inferno of flames. It's on fire! When all of a sudden, through the window comes Mayor LaGuardia. Hey! Remember who paid for that. Go easy on it.
Then I'm missing, am I?
How do you like it so far?
Then it's put Johnny to sleep.
Well, if he don't have more interest than that, then he don't get a drink. Alright, it's 3 days later and I've been transferred. And I'm under charges. That's because somebody stole my badge. Alright, I'm walking my beat. Staten Island, 46th Precinct. When the guy I'm following turns out is actually following me. Do not let anybody in. So, I think I'm going to outsmart. There's a vacant house on the corner, so I go in.
It's Bob's! Bob's! Oh, Johnny.
Bob's standing in the dark, and I see the doorknob turn. I pull my guns, brace myself against the wall, and says, "Come in!" Well, hey, gals!
What the hell is going on here?
Well, what do you know, Pat? This is Mortimer Brewster. We're writing a play together.
Did you have to tie him up so you could listen?
Joe, you better report in at the station. The whole force is out looking for you.
Did they send you here for me?
We didn't know you was here.
We came to warn the old lady serves hell to be paid. That colonel blew the bugle in the middle of the night.
Well, the neighbors been calling and he thought the Germans dropped a bomb on Flatbush Avenue.
Lieutenant's on the border route. She says the colonel's got to be put away someplace.
Oh, yes. Yes.
Huh. Well, gee, Mr. Brewster, I gotta get away. So I'll just run through the back.
No, you get away from me.
Hey, say, do you know what time is? It's after 8 o'clock in the morning.
Oh, gee, Mr. Brewster. Huh. I didn't realize how long those 2 hours went. But I just don't see anything we can leave out.
You can leave all of it out.
Who the hell's this guy?
Well, that's my brother.
Oh, the one that ran away. So he came back?
Yes, he came back.
This is Brophy. Get him back. I better let him know we found you, Joe. Mac, tell the lieutenant she can call off the big manhunt. We got him. In the Brewster house. Do you want us to bring him in? All right, we'll keep him right here. Lieutenant's on her way over.
Oh. So, I've been turned in, eh? Well, all right, you got me. I suppose you're gonna, with that stool pigeon brother of mine, you're gonna share the reward, huh?
Reward?
I got some turning in of my own to do. You think my aunts are two sweet, charming old ladies, but there's 13 bodies buried in there somewhere.
Oh, Teddy? Teddy?
What the hell are you talking about?
You better be careful what you're saying about your aunts. They happen to be friends of ours.
Well, come on. I'll prove it to you. I'll show you. Come down to the cellar with me.
Wait a minute. Wait a minute.
Trying to kill Klein.
All I said was to let Boris Karloff.
didn't tip you off he came out of the nut house.
I thought he talked kind of crazy. Oh, it's Shakespeare. Where have you been all night? And you didn't bother to tell me.
Well, I've been right here, ma'am, right to play with Mortimer Brewster.
Yeah. You don't have plenty of time to write that play now.
You're suspended. Now get back and report in.
Well, can I come over to the station sometime and use the typewriter?
No! Now get out of this! Take this guy somewhere and bring him too. See what you can find out about his accomplice. The guy who helped him escape, he's wanted too. No wonder Brooklyn's in the shape it's in. Police force for flatheads like you. Falls for that kind of story. 13
bodies. But there are 13 bodies buried in the cellar.
Who are you?
I'm President Roosevelt.
Hell is this?
That's the fellow that blows the bugle.
Good morning, Colonel.
Well, Colonel, you flung your last bugle.
Another double fever victim.
What?
All the bodies in this cellar are yellow fever victims.
No, Colonel, this is a spy we caught in the White House.
Can you get this guy out of here?
If there's any questioning of spies, that's my department.
You keep out of this.
You're forgetting, as President of the United States, I am also head of the Secret Service.
Captain, I'm Mortimer Brewster.
Are you sure?
I'm here to speak to you about my brother, Teddy, the one who blew the bugle.
Mr. Brewster, we ain't gonna talk about that. He's got to be put away.
Well, I quite agree with you. In fact, it's all been arranged. I've had these papers signed by Dr. Gilchrist, a family physician, and Teddy signed them himself, you see, and well, I signed his next to kin.
So where's he going?
Happydale.
All right, I don't care where he goes, as long as he goes.
Oh, he's going, all right. And I want you to know that everything that's happened here, Teddy is responsible for. Now, those 13 bodies in the cellar.
Yeah, those 13 bodies in the cellar. It ain't enough the neighbors were all afraid of him, and he's disturbing the peace with his bugle. But can you imagine what would happen if this cock-eyed story of 13 bodies in the cellar got around? Now, he's starting a yellow fever scare.
Who would believe a story like that?
You can't ever tell. Some people are just dumb enough. They don't know what to believe sometimes. About a year ago, this crazy guy started a murder rumor over in Greenpoint. I had to dig up a half acre lot just to prove that there was.
One moment, please.
Good morning, Mortimer.
Good morning, dear.
This is Mr. Witherspoon. He's come to meet Teddy.
To meet Teddy?
Yes, he's the superintendent of Happydale.
Oh, come in. This is Captain,
Lieutenant Rooney. I'm glad you're here, Super. You're taking him back with you today.
Today? I thought that...
But not today!
Look, Elena, I've got a lot of business to attend to, so well, you just run along home, eh?
Come in!
I had no idea it was this immediate.
The papers are all signed. He goes today.
Complete insubordination! You ladies will find out I know mollycoddle! When the President of the United States is treated like that, what's this country come to?
There's your man, Super.
One moment, please. Well, Mr. President, I have good news for you. Your term in office is over.
Is it March the 4th?
Let me see. Oh! Now I go on my hunting trip to Africa! Well, I must get started immediately! Is he trying to move into the White House before I move out?
Sorry about Superintendent. I want to get this all cleaned up. 13 bodies? sign right there, yes.
And you sign right here, Aunt Abby.
I'm really looking forward to going. The neighborhood here has changed so.
Just imagine, a front lawn again.
Oh, I'm afraid we're overlooking something.
What?
Well, we're going to need the signature of a doctor.
Oh. Dr. Einstein! You come over here for a minute. We have some papers we want you to sign.
Please, I must be going.
Well, it would only take a minute, Doctor. Just come right this way. Oh, at some point last night, I thought the doctor here was going to operate on me.
Were you leaving, Doctor?
I think I must go.
Are you going without Jonathan?
I don't think we're going to the same place.
Glad to see you, Elaine. Stick around, huh?
Oh, don't worry. I'm going to.
Hello, Matt? Rooney. We got that guy that's wanted in Indiana. There's a description of his accomplice. It's right here on the desk. Read it to me. About 30 years old. Around 6 foot tall. 180 pounds. Dark brown eyes. Speaks with a German accent. Last seen wearing a dark green jacket. Poses as a doctor. Thanks, Matt.
It's all right, Lieutenant. The doctor here has completed the signatures.
Thanks, Doc.
Upstairs?
Yes, I'll show you. Right this way.
No, Mortimer. You stay here. We want to talk with you. Yes, Mr. Witherspoon. Upstairs and to the right.
Mortimer, now that we're moving, this house really is yours.
We want you to live here now.
Oh, it's Abby. Well, I couldn't live here. There's too many, memories.
But you and Elaine will need a home when you're married.
Oh, darling, that's very indefinite.
Oh, it's nothing of the sort. We'll be married right away.
Mortimer, there is something that we're very worried about.
Oh, don't worry about it. You're going to love it at Happy Dale.
Oh, we're very happy about the whole thing. But that's just it. We don't want anything to go wrong.
Do you think they're investigate those signatures?
No, they're not going to look into Dr. Einstein.
It's not his signature, dear. It's yours.
You see, you signed as next of kin.
Yes, of course.
Well, you see, dear, it's something that we need to tell you, but we never really wanted to. But now that you're a man, and Elaine should know, too, you're not really a rooster.
You see, your mother came to us as a cook, and you were born about 3 months later. And she was such a sweet woman and such a good cook that we didn't want to lose her. So Brother married her.
I'm not really a rooster?
Not that badly about it, dear.
And it shouldn't matter to you either, Elaine.
Elaine! What did you hear? Do you understand? I'm a bastard!
Father has gone to Philadelphia, and Mortimer and I are going to have breakfast together.
Yes. so I really need some coffee. I've had quite a night.
Then in that case, I think you should want to go to bed.
Oh, I do.
Someplace
blueberry wine.
Yes, we make it ourselves.